Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Priya Sipaha. Today we will discuss jurisdiction of Supreme Court in India. According to Article 124 of the Indian Constitution, there shall be a Supreme Court of India. The constitutional powers and jurisdiction of the Supreme Court have been defined from Article 124 to 147. The Supreme Court is meant to be the highest court of appeal, which takes up appeals against the verdict of high courts. Supreme Court at the apex of Indian judiciary to uphold the Constitution of India, to protect the rights and liberties of citizens, and to uphold the value of rule of law. There are various jurisdictions of Supreme Court of India. I will discuss some of the important jurisdictions. The first one is original jurisdiction, which is defined under Article 131. Second is advisory jurisdiction under Article 143. Third is law declared by the Supreme Court binding on all courts in India. This is under Article 141. And fourth is a court of record and has a power to punish for contempt, which has been mentioned under Article 129. And fifth is it is the highest court of appeal in the country. And sixth is writ jurisdiction. Now, from the next slides, I will discuss these jurisdictions in detail. The first jurisdiction has been mentioned under Article 131 of the Indian Constitution, which says that Supreme Court has original, appellate, and advisory jurisdiction. Its exclusive original jurisdiction extends to any dispute between the Government of India and one or more states, or between the Government of India and any state or states on one side, and one or more states on the other, or between two or more states, if and in so far as the dispute involves any question, whether of law or of fact, on which the existence or extent of a legal rights depend. Under Order 40 of the Supreme Court rules, the Supreme Court may review its judgment or order, but no application for review is to be entertained in a civil proceeding except on the ground mentioned in Order 47, Rule 1 of the Code of Civil Procedure, and in criminal proceeding except on the ground of an error apparent on the face of the record. The second jurisdiction is defined under Article 143, that is advisory jurisdiction, which says that the Indian Constitution confers upon the Supreme Court advisory jurisdiction. The President may seek the opinion of the Supreme Court on any question of law or fact of public importance on which he thinks it expedient to obtain such an opinion. On such reference from the President, the Supreme Court, after giving it such hearing as it deemed fit, may report to the President its opinion thereon. The opinion is only advisory, which the President is free to follow or not to follow. However, even if the opinion given in the exercise of advisory jurisdiction may not be binding, it is entitled to great weight. The next jurisdiction is defined under Article 141 of the Indian Constitution, which states that law declared by the Supreme Court to be binding on all courts within the territory of India. It also states that only the ratio decidendi of a case is binding, not the obiter dicta and the mere facts of the cases. Therefore, while applying the decision of Supreme Court by other courts, what is required is to understand the true principle laid down by the previous decision. Let's discuss some of the basic concept of Article 141. The first is all the courts in India are bound by law to follow the decision of the Supreme Court. Firstly, the judgment has to be read as a whole, and at the same point, the observation from the judgment has to be determined in the light of the question presented before the court. Judgment is used as a precedent only if it is based on deciding or resolving a question of law. Sometimes, while deciding a case, court is divided. During that situation, the decision taken by the majority of judges will be later used as a precedent, not the decision taken by the minority of judges. Ex parte decision by Supreme Court are also binding in nature and can be used as precedent. Supreme Court is not bounded by its own decision. Procedural irregularities and immateriality do not invalidate the binding nature of judgment. Special leave petition is binding in nature. Next is types of precedent. The first one is original and declaratory precedents. Second is authoritative or binding precedent. And third is persuasive precedent. Original precedent refer to those cases where there is a question of law which has not been decided before. And then in such a case, the decision of the judges forms original. An original precedent is a law for the future which creates and applies new rules. Declaratory precedent means those cases where the application of an existing rule of law is used. In such cases, it is seen that the rule is applied because a law already existed on it. Next is authoritative or binding precedent. It is also known as mandatory precedent or as a binding authority. It means those decisions which the judge must follow whether they approve it or not. It basically denotes the higher court's decisions which are binding over the lower courts of that. The next is persuasive precedent. These precedents are not as binding as the authoritative precedents. These precedents mean that while making any judgment, the judge has to consider these precedents and has to give higher weightage to it. The main concept behind considering it is that it is relevant and can help in making a fair decision. These cases could be put at a similar level in the hierarchy of the courts. In India, the decision of one high court can act as persuasive precedent in other high courts. The next is the Supreme Court is a court of record as its decisions are of evidentiary value and cannot be questioned in any court. A court of record means a court whereof the acts and judicial proceedings are enrolled for a perpetual memorial and testimony, and which has power to fine and imprison for the contempt of its authority. Under Article 129 and 142 of the Constitution, the Supreme Court has been vested the power to punish for contempt of court, including the power to punish the contempt of itself. In case of contempt, other than the contempt referred to the Rule 2, Part 1 of the Rules of Regulate Proceeding for Contempt of the Supreme Court, 1975, the court may take actions such as suo motu or on a petition made by the Attorney General or Solicitor General or on a petition made by any person and in the case of a criminal contempt with the consent in writing of the Attorney General or the Solicitor General. The Supreme Court of India also have appellate jurisdiction. There are basically three types of appeal in Supreme Court. The first one is appeal in constitutional matter. Under Article 132(1) of the Constitution of India, an appeal shall lie to the Supreme Court from any judgment, decree or final order of a High Court, whether in civil, criminal or other proceeding, if the High Court certifies under Article 134(a) that the case involves a substantial question of law as to the interpretation of this Constitution. The next is an appeal in civil cases. Article 133 provides that an appeal shall lie to the Supreme Court from any judgment, decree or final order in a civil proceeding of a High Court only if High Court certifies under Article 134A that the case involves a substantial question of law of general importance, and that in the opinion of the High Court, the said question needs to be decided by the Supreme Court. The third type of appeal is an appeal in criminal cases. Article 134 provides that an appeal shall lie in the Supreme Court from any judgment, final order, or sentence in a criminal proceeding of a High Court. This appeal can be of two types. The first one is without a certificate of High Court, and second, with a certificate of the High Court. An appeal lies without the certificate of the High Court. First, it has an appeal reverse an order of acquittal of an accused person and sentence him to death. Second, it has withdrawn for trial before itself any case from any court subordinate to its authority and has in such trial convicted the accused person and sentenced him to death. Now, the last jurisdiction of Supreme Court, which is very important, is Article 32, that is writ jurisdiction. The Supreme Court has concurrent jurisdiction with the High Court to issue direction, orders, and writ for enforcement of fundamental rights. These writs make the Supreme Court a protector and guarantor of fundamental rights. The idea is that in case of violation of a law or rights, the court may issue direction for compliance with the Constitution. There are five types of writs as below. The first one is habeas corpus, second mandamus, third prohibition, fourth certiorari, and fifth is quo-warranto. The first is habeas corpus. It is a Latin term which literally means you may have the body. The writ is issued to produce a person who has been detained, whether in prison or in private custody, before a court and to release him if such detention is found illegal. The principal aim of this writ is to ensure swift judicial review of alleged unlawful detention on liberty or freedom of the prisoner or detention. The next is writ of mandamus. This is a Latin word which means we command. Mandamus is an order from the Supreme Court or High Court to a lower court or tribunal or public authority to perform a public or statutory duty. This writ of command is issued by the Supreme Court or High Court when any government, court, corporation, or any public authority has to do a public duty but fails to do so. The function of mandamus is to keep the public authority within the limits of their jurisdiction while exercising public functions. The next writ is certiorari. It is a Latin word being a passive form of word certiorari, which means to inform. The writ of certiorari or a writ in the nature of certiorari can only be issued by Supreme Court under Article 32 and a High Court under Article 226. Accurately, certiorari means to be certified. The writ of certiorari can be issued by the Supreme Court or by the High Court for quashing the order already passed by an inferior court, tribunal, or quasi-judicial authority. Following conditions are necessary for the issue of this writ. The first one is, there should be court, tribunal, or an officer having the legal authority to determine the question with a duty to act judicially. Second, such a court, tribunal, or officer must have passed an order acting without jurisdiction in exercise of the judicial authority vested by law in such court, tribunal, or officer. The third is, the order could also be against the principle of natural justice, or the order could contain an error of judgment in appreciating the facts of the cases. The next is writ of prohibition, which means to forbid or to stop, and it is popularly known as stay order. The writ is issued when a lower court or a body tries to transgress the limit or powers vested in it. The writ of prohibition is issued by any high court or the Supreme Court to any inferior court or quasi-judicial body, prohibiting the latter from continuing the proceeding in a particular case where it has no jurisdiction to try. After the issue of this writ, proceeding in the lower court, etc., comes to a stop. The last one is the writ of quo-warranto. It literally means, what is your authority? The writ of quo-warranto is used to judicial control executive action in the matter of making appointment to public officer under relevant statutory provisions. The writ is also used to protect a citizen from the holder of a public office to which he has no right. If a person has usurped a public office, the court may direct him not to carry out any activities in the office, or may announce the office to be vacant. Thus, High Court may issue a writ of quo-warranto if a person holds an office beyond his retirement age. Now, there are certain conditions for issue of quo-warranto. First, the office must be public and it must be created by a statute or by the Constitution itself. The office must be substantive one and not merely the function or employment of a servant at the will and during the pleasure of another. There must have been a contravention of the Constitution or statutory instrument in appointing such officer to that office. Thus, the citizens of India are secured as far as fundamental rights are concerned. The Supreme Court has the power to declare a law passes by the legislature null and void if it encroaches upon the fundamental rights. It has exercised in this power on several occasions. This shows how the Supreme Court has always served as a guardian of fundamental rights. Further, the Supreme Court has also assumed additional duties under a concept called public interest litigation, commonly known as PIL, under which any citizen can bring any matter of general importance to the general public for considering of the Supreme Court. If the Supreme Court finds that the executive has been failing in the due discharge of its duty, it passes the required direction to the concerned authority in government. Now let's discuss briefly writs. The first is habeas corpus, which means you may have the body, and the purpose is to release a person who has detained unlawfully, whether in prison or in private custody. The second one is mandamus, which means we command, and the purpose is to secure the performance of public duties by a lower court, tribunal or public authority. Third is certiorari, which means to be certified, and the purpose is to quash the order already passed by an inferior court, tribunal or quasi-judicial authority. Fourth is prohibition. Meaning is to prohibit or stop, and the purpose is to prohibit an inferior court from continuing the proceeding in a particular case where it has no jurisdiction to try. And the last one is quo-warranto, which means what is your authority, and the purpose is to restrain a person from holding a public office which he is not entitled. This is all about the jurisdiction of Supreme Court in India. If you want a detailed notes, you may visit to my website, that is priyasipaha.com. Hope you like the video. Thank you for watching. See you soon. Bye-bye.